It first started in 1967 when I found out that I had not gotten the big picture, even though I thought that I had it together. I just didn't have the complete pieces of the picture. This is a giant geopsychopolitical picture, and things are happening with the use of subliminal, indirect, and reverse psychological propaganda. It's made to be confusing by the evil archy that controls not only the United States, but Britain. This Illuminati, this group who called themselves the Enlightened Ones, had gained positions of power through control of the banking system.
On the back of the dollar bill, you'll see the symbol on the left-hand side of the bill, which is Anuit Coeptus, which means our enterprise is now a success, or our enterprise is crowned with success. Anuit Coeptus. So you're saying, fine, so you have an enterprise and it's now crowned with success. What enterprise are you talking about? Novas Ordo Seclorum. Novas is novas, meaning new. Ordo is order, and seclorum is where we get the word secular, meaning the world. So it's new order of the world, the new world order. George Bush's new world order is now a success.
Bill, you've heard an awful lot of dramatic speeches and seen dramatic moments in times of great gravity for the nation. How would you assess this evening?
This was a stirring address, in my view. Shorter than his father's speech when he announced the New World Order. Shorter than his father's speech when he announced the New World Order.
'34 is when the Federal Reserve actually finally took total control of the United States monetary system, and that's when they said it is now a success, because this is a symbol, this is an emblem of a secret society of Freemasons called the Illuminati, the German Bavarian Illuminati. They were a secret society founded in the south of Germany. They were called the Illuminati, the Illuminated Ones, the Enlightened Ones. Anuit Coeptus, Novas Ordo Seclorum, and that was in 1774 that the Bavarian Illuminati drew up their plans for what they were going to do in America and how they were going to do it. The triangle at the top with the light emanating from around it is Horus. The god of the ancient Egyptians, of course, this is an Egyptian pyramid. You don't find pyramids in America, you find them in Egypt. And that pyramid is the symbol of the eye, was in the Egyptian religion, Horus, which was the newborn sun. Every morning when the sun came up, his name was Horus. There was that was the solar divinity in Egypt. Horus was God's son, the light of the world, who is risen. He is our risen savior, our risen. And so Horus was referred to as God's son, and that's why the light is emanating from around, because it's the sun. The sun is a round eyeball of God, the ancient Egyptians believed. The pupil of God, was the sun, and he's watching you. And therefore, the sun was very bright, and so today we even say someone who is extremely intelligent is brilliant. They're bright. And that's why God is, of course, the most brilliant of all. Therefore, the sun is the most brilliant, because it's God's eye. All right, anyway, there are 13 layers on the pyramid. And the 1776 at the bottom is 1776. A lot of people think it's because of the country being founded in 1776. It has nothing to do with that. As I said, This is on a document published back in 1774, 75, and then in 1776, the Roman numerals appeared on it in Europe. So what it amounted to is that the 1776 was when this secret society actually formed itself into a secret society and put itself into operation. They were the basis for what we call today in our country the Bavarian Illuminati was the basis for what we call today the Colombian faction. The Colombian faction of the Illuminati came here right after this government was formed, and that's where we get today this Columbia Space Shuttle, Columbia Movies, Columbia Television, you know, Columbia Records, everything, Columbia University. As a matter of fact, Columbia TV, Columbia Broadcasting System, CBS. What is the symbol for CBS? It's the all-seeing eye. And that's why our government is in the District of Columbia, because these guys own our government. They print our money, and they own not only the government, but they own you. You are their property. So, in other words, these guys print the money, they run the country, and they own you, and they own everything around it. And so they make the laws. And that's why they can decide who can kill who and who can get away with who and who can get away with whatever, because they make the laws and they decide. All right. As I said to you before, there are 13 layers in this pyramid. There are 13 letters in Anno Coeptis. But 13 is a very important number to this secret society. There are 13 stripes. There are 13 stars here, which make up the Star of David. The 13 berries, there are 13 leaves, 13 arrows. There are 32 feathers here and 33 feathers there. Everything is done in sequence of 13. 13, of course, is based on, this is what we call Masonic symbolism. Freemasons designed this dollar bill. Everything is done in sequence of 13, and again, I draw your attention to the fact that you have 13 stars here, which collectively make up the Star of David. There's a reason why. On the $1 bill at the top, you'll see this little image right here. But if you blow it up from an actual photograph, you'll see it is a little owl. It's a symbol of the Bohemian Society. The Bohemian Society meets in California on the last 2 weeks of July of every year. I have pictures showing all of the presidents, all of the living presidents, excluding the new one, but all of the living presidents at the Bohemian Grove in Northern California, and they're all wearing red and black Ku Klux Klan dress type of regalia, like a Ku Klux Klaners, with the pointed headdress and everything. And I mean, that's quite a sight to see presidents dressed like Ku Klux Klan members, right? And they're standing in front of a big open pit of fire, and behind them is about a 20 to 25 foot owl behind them. And the article in Elm magazine and Time magazine, I've got two or three different magazines showing basically the same pictures. It says that the presidents meet with all of the heads of industry throughout the world, all of the heads of state throughout the world, and all of the most important wheeler dealers in this country, and they all meet up in Northern California, and they have rituals where they go before the owl after midnight. And what a picture you got, with all the presidents dressed up like Ku Klux Klaners with black and red robes on before an owl. And these are your presidents of this country. And the reason why they chose the owl is because the owl is a symbol used in Europe by secret societies, because the owl is wise, because it sees things in the dark. And the implication is, of course, that's why they are where they are, because they're very brilliant and they know things that you don't know.
The factory, the product being manufactured, is you.
benevolence which would pursue us here has lost its power under these friendly trees. So shall we burn thee once again this night, and in the flames that eat thine effigy, we shall read the sign.
You are watching a mock human sacrifice, part of a ritual that takes place in a secluded redwood grove in Northern California each summer. The sacrifice is made in front of a 40-foot stone owl and mirrors the ancient practice of child sacrifice to Molech practiced by the Canaanites. However, this is not a gathering of fringe cult members. In fact, those attending the ritual are members of the ultra-exclusive Bohemian Club of San Francisco, a group whose members include prominent academics, captains of industry, and politicians. Past members of the Bohemian Club have included President Eisenhower, President Nixon, and President Reagan. Current members include former President George Herbert Walker Bush and his son, President George Walker Bush. In July of 2000, researcher and documentary filmmaker Alex Jones became the first non-member ever to sneak into the Bohemian Grove with a hidden video camera. His footage of this mock human sacrifice, called the Cremation of Care Ritual, remains the only footage of the ritual available to the public. His documentary Dark Secrets Inside Bohemian Grove contains this footage of the mock human sacrifice committed at the grove.
Hail, fellowship's eternal flame! Once again, Midsummer sets us free!
In June 2007, Alex Jones was anonymously sent the Bohemian Club member roster for 2006. The roster, unsurprisingly, contained a number of well-known names, such as David Rockefeller, Henry Kissinger, George H.W. Bush, Gerald Ford, and others. But academia was also well represented in the list. Of course, most of the academics on the Bohemian Club roster came from Californian universities, but some came from universities outside of California. One of those is Professor Barry Cooper of the University of Calgary. Barry Cooper is a professor of political theory and Canadian politics at the University of Calgary in Western Canada. He's also a fellow of the Canadian Defense and Foreign Affairs Institute, the Royal Society of Canada, the Institute for Health Economics, and the Center for Military and Strategic Studies. He's also closely connected to Canadian Prime Minister Stephen Harper, being a part of the so-called Calgary School of Political Philosophy, from which Harper sprang. The Corbett Report recently talked to Barry Cooper about his involvement in the Bohemian Club of San Francisco. Dr. Barry Cooper, I understand that you're a member of the Bohemian Club of San Francisco.
Well, I am. It's a social club, and it's one of the attributes of it is we don't talk about it.
I see. Is there anything that you can talk about regarding that club?
No.
I see. Are you planning on going to the Grove this year?
I think I will be, yes.
Oh, I see. Have you ever participated in the Cremation of Care ritual?
No.
No? I see. Have you ever invited Prime Minister Stephen Harper to the Grove?
No.
I see. Do you ever mention the Grove when you're talking to your students about the power structures that govern global geopolitics?
I doubt it.
Don't you think it would be a good idea to talk about two-week outings with presidents and advisors and academics and other luminaries in front of 40-foot stone owls?
I don't know. I mean, generally what I do in my classes is I take texts and discuss what the texts mean.
I see. And were you aware that in the year 2000, documentary filmmaker Alex Jones actually crashed the Bohemian Grove ritual and got some footage of the cremation of care ritual out that's now widely available on the web?
No.
Really? Do you find that interesting?
I don't know.
Apparently so. Well, I recommend that you check that out, actually. It's quite some interesting footage, and I think it's one of those things that perhaps doesn't come up in political science classes, but which might have some bearing on the political situation that we're in these days. Hello, Dr. Cooper?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Yeah. Is there anything at all that you can tell us about the Bohemian Club?
Nothing that you probably couldn't find on the web.
Okay. Well, excellent. Well, if you run into David Rockefeller or Henry Kissinger this year at the club, could you give them a message that the people are waking up to the real political power structure that governs the world and that the New World Order will not stand?
Yeah, sure. I'd be happy to convey your message.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Dr. Cooper.
You're welcome.
All right. Goodbye.
While in New York, we ran into the Karl Rove of four administrations. David Gergen, top presidential advisor to Ford, Reagan, George Herbert Walker Bush, and Bill Clinton. We couldn't believe our luck. It just so happens that David Gergen is also a prominent member of the Bohemian Grove, the offshoot of Skull and Bones. This insider of insiders, a staple of the White House for 22 years, got very upset when we brought up Bohemian Grove to him. He didn't deny its existence. He didn't deny that he was a member. He didn't deny the rituals. He just became angry and didn't act very gentlemanly.
The real wild card here are the demonstrators. We just don't know where this is going to go. While they were peaceful today, there's a lot more anger among those demonstrators than is evident. You talk to them today, they're pretty angry people. So that's the big wild card.
Hey, Mr. Gergen, can we talk to you for a second?
Where are you from?
I'm Alex Jones. I have a TV show in Austin. I make documentaries. Just a few questions about the convention.
Yeah, well, is our camera, or are you...
Yeah, right there, just about... Yeah, but I just want to get your permission first.
Here. Okay, it's local. I've got...
No, I understand. Just about a minute or two.
Okay, great.
We're talking to David Gergen, and he has advised several presidents and, of course, has written quite a few books and is a, I would call you a political pundit or researcher?
Commentariat, over the hill, whatever.
Okay. How long have you been in New York?
About 4 hours.
What do you think of this circus?
Well, I haven't seen all the protests yet, but I've never seen as much security for a convention as we have here. And it's, the city's... almost closed down. I think it's remarkable. I think it's an unfortunate turn for politics that we have to have this many police around.
There's been a lot of news articles and reports saying that there's a heightened risk of terror attacks. Do you think there's a chance of that?
They just arrested, I think, or broken up some plot allegedly to somebody wanted to blow up subways. Yeah, I think it's a very real danger, and you've got Madison Square Garden is sitting right, basically on top of a train station, and Boston Convention was right on top of a train station. Yeah, I just have to remember that trains are very accessible, vulnerable, and that's what happened in Spain. They went after trains, and they blew some trains up, and it wasn't very expensive. So I think there's that danger, but I think the police are on top of it. They're treating this as a special security event, which means there's not only the obvious police around, but believe me, there's a lot of private stuff going on here.
Okay, one last question. I read a Washington Times article many years ago where you had a comment about the organization, and then now it's been in the Wall Street Journal, it's been in a lot of different newspapers, and that's the Bohemian Grove. And back in, 96 when you joined as a Clinton advisor, the Republicans were criticizing you. Oh, what about Bohemian Grove? And then you countered them by saying, hey, I don't run around in the woods naked. What did that mean?
Here is the before-mentioned Washington Times article where he said, I didn't run around naked like they do.
I don't know what quote you're referring to. I'm not aware of any quote like that. I am a happy member of the Bohemian Grove. I like the folks who come there, and it's really inappropriate for me to talk about the group beyond that. Thank you.
Have you been there for the ceremony with the cremation of care?
Frankly, I don't think that's something I need to talk to you about.
Great owl of Bohemia, we thank thee for thy adjuration.
Have you been there for the ceremony with the cremation of care?
Frankly, I don't think that's something I need to talk to you about.
Really?
That's right.
Well, I'm Alex Jones, and I snuck in there in 2000. I'm the guy that blew it wide open.
And got the video. It's been on national TV.
Well, I disrespect you for that.
You do?
I do.
But it's a lot of big public officials going in there. Don't we deserve to know?
You took an I don't know anything about you, and I don't know anything about your film. But if you go in there with an understanding, you violated that understanding by releasing that film, and I don't respect you for that.
Really?
I'm sorry. You took an understanding when you went in there that you would not do that film, and you did. Did you have an understanding when you went in there?
No.
Did you crash it?
Yes.
Yeah, and it has no trespassing signs there too, doesn't it?
No, they put them up after.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, sir. I've been there before. I know what the circumstances are, and I'm sorry you violated the understandings. That was not a gentlemanly thing to do.
But what about the ritual? Is the ritual gentlemanly?
Sir, everything. I don't owe you this comment.
I know.
You have. This is what's called ambush journalism, and I disrespect you for that as well. So thank
you
and goodbye.
Have you ever been in the ritual?
That's none of your damn business.
Oh,
that's right. Listen. You go around and make understandings with people and violate them. You ambush people on the streets, and that's inappropriate form of journalism. If you wish to practice that, that's fine. But don't ask others to respect you for it. You want to, you can do it. You're free American like anything you want. If you want to be uncivil and rude and ungentlemanly, that's up to you. But don't expect the rest of us to say, oh, well, you're
there, Mr. Gergen.
I'm sorry. Nobody sets policy in there. We try to be gentlemen, and obviously you don't belong there.
Weaving spiders coming out here?
Yeah, that is a three-pointer. Woo! Boy, I hit the hot button. Mr. Gergen, have a wonderful life. Say hi to Moloch for me. Canaanite deity, and I'll see you at Eyes Wide Shut, baby. Bye-bye. Get his face. Get in there and get his face. David Gergen.
David Gergen says that we're angry?
The real wild card here are the demonstrators. We just don't know where this is going to go. While they were peaceful today, there's a lot more anger among those demonstrators than is evident. You talk to them today, they're pretty angry people. So that's a big wild card.
Thank you and goodbye.
You ever been in the ritual?
That's none of your damn business.
Oh.
That's right. Listen.
Just look at him. That's a face keeping a lot of secrets. He's got some stories to tell. And remember that Washington Times article? It talked about all the other organizations that he resigned from. It mentions the Trilateral Commission, the Council on Foreign Relations. All of them groups dedicated to setting up a world government and destroying American sovereignty.
Throughout the course of human history, leaders, religions, and ideologies have tried by force to achieve world domination.
You know where we are.
All of them failed miserably to achieve their goals. In the present age of globalization, the exponential development of telecommunication and the minimization of distance, it has been apparent to the various groups that pursue world domination that this goal can be achieved not by military, but by social and economic means.
You know where we are.
In 1979, a person named R.C. Christian appeared at the Alberton Granite Finishing Company and ordered the construction of a monument in order to communicate a message to humanity. Later, it was proven that R.C. Christian was a pseudonym. The monument consists of four vertical slabs of granite and one horizontal, which serves as a roof. On the four vertical slabs, the 10 guidelines are engraved in 8 different languages: English, Spanish, German, Hindi, Swahili, Russian, Hebrew, Chinese, and Arabic. On the horizontal slab, a shorter version of the text is engraved in 4 ancient languages: Greek, Sanskrit, Babylonian, and Egyptian hieroglyphic.
Maintain humanity under 500 million in perpetual balance with nature. Guide reproduction wisely, improving fitness and diversity. Unite humanity with a living new language. Rule passion, faith, tradition, and all things with tempered reason. Protect people and nations with fair laws and just courts. Let all nations rule internally, resolving external disputes in a world court. Avoid petty laws and useless officials. Balance personal rights with social duties. Prize truth, beauty, love, seeking harmony with the infinite. Be not a cancer on the earth. Leave room for nature. Leave room for nature.
A decalogue then, and one can't help noticing the inclusion of the Jewish language, despite the fact that it has relatively few speakers. It seems that someone is trying to stimulate the Judeo-Christianic reflexes of Americans by presenting them with 10 new commandments like New Moses. The first and second are the scariest though. Limiting the world population to 500 million and implementing an extensive eugenics program. Such a situation can be found in Aldous Huxley's novel Brave New World. The reproduction process is carried out in laboratories while families have been abolished. Humans are produced from 5 types of embryos: alphas, betas, gammas, deltas, and finally the semi-moron epsilons. Of course, I'd crave a police state like the one described in George Orwell's 1984. Now, the stones might be a prank, b a publicity stunt, or c an actual message from someone who wants to take over the world. Today, we see an increase in authoritarianism under the pretext of terrorism, the accumulation of huge economic power at the hands of few corporations, and the gradual decomposition of the welfare state wherever available. As you see, how else can the elite of today enjoy its exorbitant wealth? By screwing 5,000 models within a year? Buying 365 Ferraris, one for each day of the year? No, only absolute power over fellow humans can do that. If the citizens of the world are not alert to guard their gained rights, the future may look like a crossing between 1984 and the brave new world. One may wonder as to who is the cancer on the earth, as stated by Guideline 10. The huge corporations, maybe? Protecting the environment does not necessarily crave a reduction of the human population to 1/12 of today's level. There are other ways.
Όπου εδώ, όπως και στους άλλους λαούς, γιατί έχουμε 6, γίνονται οι συγκεντρώσεις που εργάζονται οι τέκτονες.
Των τεκτών.
Είναι τεκτονικό εργαστήριο. Λέγεται και ναός, και αυτό έχει και κάποια σημασία. Και εμείς οι οποίοι είμαστε οι μικροί εργάτες, είμαστε οι τέκτονες. Εκείνος είναι ο αρχιτέκτον.
Σχηματίσαμε και μας αλευθύνει αυσίδα.
Αντιτεκτονισμό υπάρχουν αρχιερείς οι οποίοι είναι δηλωμένοι και το ξέρει όλος ο κόσμος. Πατριαρχείο Ιεροσολύμων που ανήκει μέσα στον αντιτεκτονισμό, κάνει αγώνα κατά των αιρέσεων και ιδιαίτερα του σατανισμού. Η μασονία είναι θρησκεία. Έχουμε να κάνουμε με μια θρησκεία εδώ. Και δεν το λέμε μόνο εμείς, το λέει και η ελληνική κοινωνία. Έχει γίνει δικαστήριο πριν από μερικά χρόνια. Το 1969 που εκδόθηκε και η απόφαση 2060 που κατακεραυνώνει τον μασονισμό ότι είναι θρησκεία όλος διάφορος της χριστιανικής, όπως επίσης και πολύ παλαιότερα η Εκκλησία το 1933 για τον ίδιο η μασονία ξεκινάει και έχει τις ρίζες στο σατανισμό, στον νεοσφορισμό που είναι μια εξέλιξη σε σημερινή μορφή. Υπάρχει η μασονία, υπάρχουν οι ιστορίες τους, από εκεί υπάρχουν τα στελέχη που βγαίνουν και γίνονται μέχρι και σατανιστές. Είναι ένα ολόκληρο κύκλωμα, δεν εξηγείται δηλαδή μέσα σε λίγα λεπτά το θέμα της μασονίας. Εκείνο που πρέπει να καταλάβει η κοινωνία μας είναι ότι έχουμε να κάνουμε με ένα πρόβλημα, με μια κοινωνική ασθένεια. Είναι κοινωνική ασθένεια η μασονία. Δηλαδή δεν γίνεται σήμερα να είσαι, παραδείγματος χάρη, δικαστής και μασόνος. Δεν γίνεται να είσαι πρόεδρος δημοκρατίας και μασόνος. Δεν γίνεται να είσαι οικουμενικός πατριάρχης και μασόνος.
Εφόσον οι μασονικές στοές είναι τόσο κλειστές, πώς είναι τόσο εύκολο να βρεθούν τα έγγραφα αυτά και να δοθούν στον τύπο?
Μα δεν είναι καθόλου δύσκολο. Τα έγγραφα έχουν δοθεί στον τύπο, έχουν γίνει μηνύσεις στο παρελθόν από ανθρώπους με χιλιάδες έγγραφα μέσα από μασονικές στοές και δυστυχώς, μα δυστυχώς το λέω, έχουν φτάσει τα στοιχεία ακόμα και μέσα στη Βουλή των Ελλήνων, έχουν χαθεί έχουν εξαφανιστεί και πάλι στο προσκήνιο η μασονία κάθε 3, 4 και 5 χρόνια βγαίνουν πάλι τα ίδια τα στοιχεία και πάλι τα καλύπτουν. Ως πότε θα γίνεται αυτό το πράγμα?
Ποιοι τα καλύπτουνε?
Τι τα καλύπτουνε? Κατ' εμένα ναι, έπρεπε η δικαιοσύνη να έχει επιληθεί. Έπρεπε ο εισαγγελέας εδώ και καιρό να μας έχει καλέσει και να έχουμε καταθέσει όλη αυτή τη βιβλιογραφία, όλη αυτή την αρθογραφία μέσα στις εφημερίδες, όλα αυτά τα στοιχεία, να κληθεί επιτέλους όλος αυτός ο κόσμος να βγάλουμε μία άκρη. Είναι θέμα εισαγγελέως. Δεν μπορούμε να κάνουμε εμείς τη δουλειά του εισαγγελέως. Γι' αυτό μέσα το κράτος έχει εισαγγελέα για να κάνει αυτή τη δουλειά. Γι' αυτό υπάρχει η θέση του εισαγγελέως. Ιδάλλως θα έπρεπε να είχε καταργηθεί. Είναι γραμμένο παντού. Οι αρχιμασόνοι, Καραμαλής, Παπανδρέου, Ράλης, 1000 ονόματα. Αυτά είναι γραμμένα. Είναι... Από δεκάδες συγγραφείς βιβλίων, εφημερίδων. Δηλαδή τα τελευταία 50 χρόνια δεν κάνουμε τίποτε άλλο από το να αναμασούμε τα ίδια και τα ίδια λόγια. Οι μασόνοι επιδιώκουν διαδόλου να παίρνουν την εξουσία στα χέρια τους. Διαδόλου. Είναι άνθρωποι που επιθυμούν και επιδιώκουν την εξουσία. Και φτάνουν ακόμα και σε αποτελέσματα σαν αυτά τα οδυνηρά που έχουμε στη σύγχρονη εποχή. Δηλαδή, πάρα πολλά πολιτικά κόμματα που οι αρχηγοί τους να είναι μασόνοι, να επιδιώκουν ο ένας να κυνηγάει τον άλλον. Τα φαινόμενα, όπως βλέπετε, δεν εξαπατούν. Αν παρακολουθήσουμε βουλή, βλέπουμε τον πρόεδρο του ενός κόμματος να καταφέρεται κατά του άλλου πρόεδρου του άλλου κόμματος, της αντιπολιτεύσεως. Για να κρατάμε την εξουσία στα χέρια μας, ένα όπλο είναι η μασονία. Προβάλλοντας τη μασονία, δηλαδή το μασονικό τους χαρακτήρα, καταφέρουν και έχουν την εξουσία στα χέρια τους. Βέβαια, ο ελληνικός λαός δεν ξέρει τι είναι η μασονία σε ουσία και γι' αυτό δεν δίνει βάση. Και γι' αυτό πάει και ψηφίζει ανθρώπους που δεν έχει καταφέρει ακόμα να δει ποιο είναι το ποιόν τους. Όταν πας και ψηφίζεις έναν πολιτικό του οποίου το ποιόν είναι μασόνος και που τίνει να γίνει σατανιστής, γιατί οι περισσότεροι εκεί καταλήγουν, από εκεί και πέρα. Τι να πούμε, οι μασόνοι μπορούν να παίρνουν οποιαδήποτε θέση θέλουν. Το ξαναλέω. Δικαίωμά τους να παίρνουν οποιαδήποτε θέση θέλουν. Και παίρνουν οποιαδήποτε θέση θέλουν, διότι όπως ξέρουμε πάρα πολύ καλά, έχουν διεισδύσει στο στρατό, στην εκκλησία, στην πολιτεία. Και αυτή τη στιγμή επιζητούμε να βρούμε πρόεδρο δημοκρατίας, δυστυχώς μέσα από μασονικά κυκλώματα.
Το 1997 ήταν μια πολύ σημαντική χρονιά για τους μασόνους στην Τουρκία. Έγιναν μυστικές βιντεοσκοπήσεις μέσα από μασονικούς ναούς και αυτά τα βίντεο προβλήθηκαν από το κανάλι 7 για πολλές μέρες. Τα μυστικά βίντεο που καταγράφτηκαν σε δύο διαφορετικές στοές σόκαραν μαζί με τον τουρκικό λαό και τους μασόνους που δεν είχαν φτάσει σε υψηλό βαθμούς μύησης. Η αποκάλυψη των μασόνων που προστάτευαν την ιδιωτικότητά τους από την ίδρυση της πρώτης μασονικής στοάς στην Κωνσταντινούπολη το 1738 και η εμφάνιση του πραγματικού προσώπου της μασονίας συζητήθηκαν για πολλές ημέρες. Σύστησέ μας τους υποψηφίους. Σερτάπ Μπιούκουσουν, η δουλειά του είναι ηλεκτρολόγος μηχανικός. Αϊκούτ Ερενσόι, η δουλειά του είναι ηλεκτρολόγος μηχανικός. Κενάν Αλί Ακμάν, η δουλειά του είναι το ελεύθερο εμπόριο. Η ταυτοποίηση των υποψηφίων έγινε. Κατανοητή. Φέρ τους μέσα. Αγαπητοί κύριοι, πέρα από οτιδήποτε άλλο θα θέλαμε να μας υποσχεθείτε ότι αν θα γίνετε αποδεκτοί να ενταχθείτε σε εμάς ή όχι από την ώρα που θα βρεθείτε μέσα στην σκοτεινή ζώνη, την οποία εμείς ονομάζουμε αίθουσα διαλογισμού, δεν θα πείτε σε κανέναν τι έχετε δει και τι έχετε ακούσει μέχρι τώρα και τι θα ακούσετε από εδώ και στο εξής και τι θα δείτε μετά που θα ανοίξουν τα μάτια σας. Το υπόσχεστε στην τιμή σας. Κύριε Αϊκούτ Ερσόι, ναι, δίνω υπόσχεση. Κύριε Σερτάντ Μπουίκουστουμ, ναι, δίνω υπόσχεση. Κύριε Κενάν Αλί Ακμάν, ναι, το υπόσχομαι. Αδελφέ μου, εξεταστεί βοήθα τους υποψηφίους να καθίσουν. Κύριε Σερτάντ Μπουίκουστουμ, μπορείτε να μας πείτε τι είναι αυτό το πράγμα που έχει αγγίξει το στήθος σας και το έχετε αισθανθεί με το ένα χέρι? Είναι ένα κομμάτι μέταλλο, σπαθί. Κύριε Αϊκούτ Ερενσόι, μπορείτε να μας πείτε τι είναι αυτό που άγγιξε το στήθος σας και το κρατήσατε με ένα από τα δύο χέρια σας? Μοιάζει με σπαθί. Η σημασία του σπαθιού που έχει αγγίξει το στήθος σας είναι ότι αν δεν κρατήσετε τις υποσχέσεις σας, θα το μετανιώσετε και θα υποφέρετε γι' αυτό για το υπόλοιπο της ζωής σας. Για να μην αφήνουμε παρερμηνίες στο μυαλό σας, θα θέλαμε να ξέρουμε το εξής. Είστε εκείνοι που πραγματικά θέλουν να ενταχθούν σε εμάς? Κύριε Αϊκού Τερενσόη, συμπληρώσατε και υπογράψατε το έντυπο αίτησης, το οποίο σας έχει δοθεί για να γίνετε μασόνος, χωρίς οποιοδήποτε πίεση από άλλους και με τη δική σας ελεύθερη βούληση και κρίση. Ναι, ας κάνουν οι υποψήφοι το πρώτο ταξίδι. Ποιοι είναι αυτοί? Είναι υποψήφοι που ψάχνουν για το φως το αληθινό. Κύριε, επαναλάβετε αυτόν τον όρκο, μετά από μένα, ο οποίος ήδη διαβάστηκε μόλις τώρα, ενώπιον της μασονικής λέσχης, η οποία βρίσκεται εδώ με τον σύμβολο του μέγιστου αρχιτέκτονα του σύμπαντος, ορκίζομαι με όλη την επιθυμία μου, όλη μου την θέληση και όλη μου την ειλικρίνεια. Δίνω υπόσχεση. Και θα αποκαλύψω μασονικά μυστικά τα οποία θα λεχθούν και θα παρουσιαστούν εδώ σε μένα, σε οποιαδήποτε άλλο εκτός από μασόνο και οπουδήποτε αλλού εκτός από μασονική στοά. Θα εργάζομαι πάντα για τους στόχους των μασόνων. Θα υπακούω στις αρχές της μεγάλης ελευθεροτεκτονικής στοάς. Θα παρευρίσκομαι κανονικά στις συναντήσεις της στοάς, στην οποία θα γίνω μέλος. Ο πρώτος αξιωματούχος, αδερφέ μου, τι θα ήθελες από τους υποψηφίους? Θέλω το φως της επιστημονικής αλήθειας, αξιότιμε διδάσκαλε. Ο αδελφέ μου που στολίζεται την αλήθεια και όλες τις στήλες της, τι θέλετε από τους υποψηφίους? Θέλουμε το φως της επιστημονικής αλήθειας, αξιότιμε διδάσκαλε. Με το τρίπτο χτύπημα του σφυριού, ας δοθεί το φως της επιστημονικής αλήθειας. Αυτά τα σπαθιά επισημαίνουν σε εσάς και συμβολίζουν ότι από εδώ και στο εξής, αν η ζωή σας δεχτεί επίθεση, οι μασόνοι θα σας υπερασπιστούν. Σε άλλες βιντεοσκοπήσεις, τις οποίες σύντομα παρουσιάζουμε μετά από αυτά τα σοκαριστικά βίντεο, η μασονία στην Τουρκία έχει πλήρως αποκαλυφθεί. Σε αυτά τα βίντεο παρουσιάστηκε ένα σατανικό τελετουργικό λατρείας, όπου μόνο ένας μασόνος 33ου βαθμού μπορεί να ενταχθεί. Ο γυρεότερος δάσκαλος που διευθύνει το τελετουργικό πίνει το αίμα μιας κατσίκας, η οποία θυσιάστηκε στον σατανά, στη μέση του πατώματος της στοάς, και κλείνει το σατανικό τελετουργικό λατρείας, λέγοντας μερικές προσευχές στα εβραϊκά. Και σε ένα άλλο βίντεο που βιντεοσκοπήθηκε σε μασονική στοά στην Κωνσταντινούπολη, ήταν μια μασονική γαμήλια τελετή, η οποία από ανέκαθεν έχει αποκηρυχτεί από τους μασόνους.
And how long were you a Mason for?
9 years.
And how high up did you go?
Well, I went through the typical Blue Lodge degrees, went through York Rite all the way up to the Knights Templar Commandery, went through the Scottish Rite all the way up to 32nd degree, and at that time, then I was considered worthy to get into what is called esoteric Freemasonry, which most American Masons don't even know exist. And in that organization, I was admitted into the Rite of Memphis Mitzrayim, and I went up to 90th degree, which a lot of Masons, if they even hear that, they will, you know, their false teeth will fall on their heads. But there are actually at least 97 degrees in the higher level esoteric rites.
From your experience?
From my experience.
I've actually heard there's 360 degrees with Satan at the top. Do you know if that's true or not?
I have no idea if that's true or not. I have heard that too, but for my information, I can only speak to that there's 90.
Right. Were you surprised when you found that there were more than 33 degrees?
No, not really. See, here's how this works. When I went through the Masonic rituals, I had the spirit guides in my ear whispering things, telling me to do things, telling me to answer certain things in certain ways. Because I did that, I was identified by the leadership of the Grand Lodge of the State of Wisconsin that I was someone a little bit extraordinary. And the spirit guides kept prompting me with these things. And I knew, before I was even asked, that there was a Rite of Memphis Mizraim because the spirit guides told me so.
Wow.
And see, that's one of the ways in which I ultimately got contacted by the Illuminati, is because the spirit guides had given me certain key things to say, key things to do, even gestures to make, stuff like that, that would identify me as being someone who was worthy of more light. You see, that's what they promise in all the Masonic degrees. They say, you know, you get light, you get further light, you get more light. And of course, where does this light come from? Well, if you read the writings of the Masonic leaders, that comes from Lucifer.
And how many Masons know that?
Maybe 1 in 1,000. Well, basically, it's its own religion. It's a religion which does not honor Yeshua, Jesus Christ. And it is a religion that demands people that they do things that are contrary to the commandments of God. And let me explain that. The oaths that I've already mentioned that you have to take, even as an entered apprentice, the lowest degree, are blood-curdling. You swear that you will have your throat cut from ear to ear, and your tongue torn out by the roots to be buried in the sands of the sea. And obviously that's going to involve a certain amount of death, you know. And the problem is that, first of all, you're swearing that oath on a Bible in the name of God. Now here's the deal. Yeshua said in Matthew chapter 5, 34 to 37, that we're not supposed to swear oaths. And that is also repeated by James in chapter 5, verse 12. That he says, above all things, my brethren, swear no oaths. So just right there, if you're a Christian and you're a Mason, you've just broken one of the commandments of your Lord and Savior. Okay. Additionally, well, the Mason might say, oh, well, these oaths don't mean anything. Well, then you're taking the name of the Lord in vain because you're swearing a false oath. Additionally, you're swearing an oath where you're swearing that you will have your body, which is a temple of the Holy Spirit, if you're a Christian, be mutilated and killed in some horrible way. So you're actually breaking three of the Ten Commandments. And plus, the other thing that, you see, I have an excuse. I was a pagan when I went into the Masons. Most Masons aren't. Most Masons are some kind of, you know, Lutherans, Baptists, Methodists, whatever. And when you begin your Masonic journey, you're made to take off all your metal, including your wedding ring, which a lot of people would have a problem with that. Additionally, they're made to put on these jammies, blue jammies, and a blindfold, which leaves their one breast bare. They have a cable toe put around their neck, which is like a blue cord, and they're led to the door of the lodge, made to knock on the door of the lodge. Some guy answers from inside the lodge, "Who comes here?" And the fellow who's your conductor answers for you and says, "Mr. Bill Sneblin, who has long been in darkness and now seeks to be brought to light, to receive a part of the rights and benefits of this worshipful lodge erected to God and dedicated to the holy saints John, as all brothers and fellows have done before him." Now, what's contained in that, if you're a Christian? You're saying you have long been in darkness and now seek to be brought to light. Mm-hmm. And you have, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, the light of the world, in your heart. And yet you're in darkness. You've just denied your Lord and Savior. Oh, probably crowding 2,000 clients now over the years.
Wow, that's a lot.
That, that we have seen literally hundreds of cases where children allege they have been sexually molested either within Masonic lodges or else by Masonic grandfathers, Masonic parents, whatever. And I believe there's a real significant spiritual reason for that. Because Masonry worships Baal. See, Baal and all those pagan gods that surrounded Israel in the Old Testament, they were all phallic fertility gods. And if you worship, knowingly or unknowingly, sex, then sex is going to come back and start corroding your soul. And you're going to start having improper sexual thoughts coming to you from demon spirits. Because when you kneel at that altar, you basically place yourself under the headship of the false god Baal, even if you're a Christian. And so you've got one knee on the altar of Yahweh God and one knee on the altar of Baal. And that's...